I have to say one little disclaimer, though, before I start. I had an emergency root canal this afternoon, which means a couple things could happen. I could dribble pasta sauce during my talk tonight because I still don't have the feeling in the left side of my face, or I've been on Vicodin for 2 days. So who knows what I'm going to say. If it's being recorded, we may have a viral video by the end of the evening. So take notes. You never know what might happen. Wayne is right. This is the way to contact me. We have a company in Burbank called Cooke Pictures, cookpictures.com. You can see some of our stuff there. I have a blog. I'm kind of an obsessive blogger, philcook.com. And you can sign up for a newsletter that we produce there. And I'm on Twitter at Phil Cooke. So please contact me on Twitter and tell me if I screwed up something or said something I'll regret on Vicodin tonight. It'll probably really, really help me. I'm thrilled to be here, and I love what you guys are doing. Absolutely thrilled. In fact, so much so that my wife, just a month ago, my wife and I started a nonprofit of our own called the Influence Lab. And we really believe that global culture, if we're going to impact it, it has to be through media. There's no question about it. We've thought about this for years. Every time I speak somewhere, somebody comes up to me and says, you know what, I'm mentoring 50 church media directors, or I'm working with 10 pastors or 100 ministry leaders in some country around the world. Can you come and speak? And so we decided, you know what, if we're going to get serious about this, we better do it. And what was interesting, and I think you'll get a kick out of this, I had a Christian radio station manager from Bangkok, Thailand, in my office last summer, and this really sparked me. We were talking, and he said, you know, this is a radio station manager of a Christian station in Bangkok. He said, please do not send me more missionaries. He said, and don't send me more guys that can build houses. And whatever you do, do not send me more high school kids on short-term missions trips. But he said, if I could have a web developer for 2 weeks, it would transform my ministry. And it dawned on me that maybe it's time to start a short-term missions program for media, technology, and communications professionals. My wife and I live and work in Hollywood. I could bring heavyweight directors, producers, writers, social media experts, all kind of talent, who in a heartbeat would go anywhere in the world for a week to teach on storytelling, filmmaking, social media, websites, whatever, if I just gave them a plane ticket. So I think that is the future. I mean, the truth is, missions is broken. I'm not telling you anything new. We're still working off a 200-year-old model. We're still sending white guys to third world countries. You know what? They're sending more missionaries to the U.S. than we send overseas now. We don't need to do that. We need to resource and equip the people that are there to do remarkable things, particularly when it comes to media. So I'm passionate about this, and I think what we're talking about this week really, really matters. And I could not be more pumped. And so what I want to do tonight, is talk about, you know, we talk about leading change, and certainly the world is going through change, and I don't know about any area that's going through more change than the media. And so I want to talk about some of the new rules out there for communicating our message. If we're going to make an impact in the media, how to do it. Now, you're all communicators, so you know that your perspective, when it comes to communicating a message, our perspective matters. The angle that you look at a message very often determines how that message is received. It can completely change the meeting and the message. So because I'm a communicator, I kind of keep track of Christians who, you know, we're telling the greatest story ever told, but we don't always tell that story really, really well. So I like to keep track of situations where we could do a better job. I found this church sign the other day that I thought was kind of funny. Some of you may have seen it. I'm sure the pastor had a good message on hell, but that's not what was communicated by that sign. And we were in the UK not long ago, and we passed a barn, and we realized that if you cover up part of your message, it can completely change the meaning. So, and you know, if you do vacation Bible school, I don't know if you do it internationally, but be careful where you put the sign, because this is the way it could come out. I like that. And I found a church sign last Easter that I thought was kind of good. I appreciated the message of resurrection, but this is the way that it looked on the sign. He is not here. Well, maybe I shouldn't go to that church. And punctuation matters. I found this sign the other day. Punctuation matters, because you could come out with, come worship Pastor Freddie Sin. That's pretty good. Put a period after worship, okay? Or at least a comma or something. I think that's important. And my favorite one of all time is The Methodists, I don't think, realized the impact of abbreviating their name for the street sign that led to their Bible camp, because this is the way that came out: Meth Bible Camp. You never ever want to send your kids to a meth Bible camp. At least they got the dead end part right, so that's good. But it's true, it happens in the secular world all the time. I went into Home Depot, big hardware store here in Burbank. Went into Home Depot the other day and I found this sign: ask an associate for a demonstration. No, I do not need that demonstrated. I get it. But you get my message. How we communicate matters, and it can have a huge impact. So I want to talk about some of the new rules for sharing your message in this incredibly changing culture today. And the book that we were talking about earlier that I just wrote about a year ago, called Unique, Telling Your Story in the Age of Brands and Social Media, is all about that. I really feel passionately that we need to think about how we share our story in this incredibly changing culture. Because the truth is, the world is changing faster than at any time in history. Most historians will tell you that historically we've looked at cultural change through 100 to 200 year increments. Then that collapsed to a generation. Now historians look at cultural change on a global basis in 5 to 10 year increments. Change is happening so fast, it's overwhelming us. We really don't know how to deal with it. In fact, when you read 7 days of a daily newspaper, you've read more information than the typical person just 100 years ago read during their entire lifetime. In fact, it's interesting that some researchers in the UK tell us we're being bombarded, Europe and America, with as many as 5,000 media messages every single day. I was in a hotel the other day that had video monitors in the elevator. I got gas last night at a gas station that had video monitors embedded in the gas pump. We're literally being overwhelmed. And we wonder why, you know, who's winning the battle of influence in our culture? Nielsen Ratings, the TV rating service here in the U.S., says that we're watching, the average home in America is watching television 8 hours and 18 minutes a day. The average television set in the U.S. is on 8 hours and 18 minutes a day. Now, the National Sleep Study Center says we're only sleeping 6 hours and 40 minutes a day, which means in the average home in the U.S., the television is on almost 2 hours longer than we sleep. We are losing the battle of influence when it comes to the media. It's incredibly important. And by the way, do you know that YouTube spends $1 million every day just expanding their server space for the number of videos that are being uploaded? Every minute, 60 hours of video are being uploaded to YouTube. It's really staggering when you look at the sheer numbers. I mean, it's just amazing. So what that means is, as communicators, as professional communicators, we have one enemy. We have one enemy, and it's this: clutter. Clutter. We live in the most cluttered culture in the history of the world. And it's not just Hong Kong or Japan. It's New York City, it's Dallas and Atlanta, Paris, London, Rome, wherever. Clutter is literally overwhelming this world. And so it's not the best message that gets through anymore. It's actually the message that knows how to cut through all that clutter and get on the radar and get noticed. And that's what we need to think about, whether we're filmmakers, whether we're writers, artists, directors, whatever we do, we have to understand what it's going to take to cut through. And you don't believe me about clutter? Look at these numbers here. 300,000 books were published in 2011. 3 million more were self-published. Nearly 1,000 movies were released that year. 60 hours of video, I mentioned that, uploaded every minute on YouTube. The average cable system now has 160. I have DirecTV. I have 500 channels on my cable. Roughly 500,000 businesses open each year, and 1.6 million nonprofits were registered with the IRS in 2011. You talk about competition. It's absolutely overwhelming. So the question becomes, how do we break through? How do we get noticed? In my book, Unique, I talk about a brand, the simple definition of a brand being a compelling story that surrounds a person or a product or an organization. It's not scary, it's not mystical, it's not weird. It's simply a perception. Everybody has a brand. Oprah has a brand. Billy Graham has a brand. Nike has a brand. United Airlines has a brand. Everybody has a brand because it's a perception. In simplest terms, it's what do people think of when they think of you? And let me tell you something. In a culture of unlimited choice, that question is incredibly important. I tell pastors, unless they have a positive perception of your church, they're never going to walk in the door. By the way, I also tell pastors that virtually 100% of people will check you out on the web before they visit your church. So why is your website so lame? Let me tell you something. In a digital world, your website becomes the most important thing you have. Perception matters. Trust me. Unless I have a good impression of Starbucks, I'm never going to walk in and try a coffee. That initial perception matters, and yet that's the hardest thing for me to get across to Christian organizations. It's why companies like Nike, Starbucks, spend millions of dollars every year just influencing their perception. Nike, you know what? There are billboards, hundreds of billboards across America and across Europe that have nothing on them but that swoosh. No words, no text, no pictures, and yet the power of that brand is so compelling that thousands of people that drive under those billboards every day know exactly who it is, what product it is, what it represents, and what it means to them. Does your logo have that kind of resonance with people? Does it echo that kind of power? Starbucks is the same way. That, you know, it's interesting. Their brand statement is a great coffee experience. Everything around Starbucks is focused on that person having a great experience. In fact, their research indicated that conversations happen better around round tables than square tables. That's why you don't see square tables at a Starbucks, except for maybe the handicap table. But they put in mostly round tables. It's interesting that about 2 years ago, they decided they could save enormous amounts of money by getting rid of their grinding machines. If they could grind the beans somewhere else, bring them into Starbucks, and just make the coffee, they could do almost a third more cups. They could move the line faster, make tons more money. And so they did. They spent millions of dollars ripping the grinding machines out of their Starbucks, and they pre-ground the beans and would start bringing them in. Well, about a year after that happened, the CEO, Howard Schultz, walked into a Starbucks, and guess what? He didn't smell coffee because no beans were being ground anymore. And he thought, you know what? We're a coffee shop. When you walk into a Starbucks, you need to have that physical experience of smelling coffee. They're so committed to their brand. They ripped all those machines out, brought back the grinders, and they're back grinding coffee machine in every Starbucks. They want you to feel that experience. In fact, it's kind of funny. A few years ago, a hotshot MBA went to Starbucks, did a sheet-by-sheet, roll-by-roll, store-by-store analysis of their toilet paper. Found out if they went from a two-ply to a single-ply toilet paper, they could save something like $30 or $40 million a year, considering the number of stores they have. So they had a big summit meeting about it, and after about 2 hours of arguing, they decided against it. Because they decided single-ply toilet paper does not make for a great coffee experience. And I agree. But they're that committed to the brand, they're willing to spend $40 million more dollars every year just to make sure people have a great experience in the bathroom. And by the way, your story, your brand, your perception trickles down in your organization. It trickles down. I was at a Starbucks in Dallas at the airport the other day. I was standing behind this really sweet little old lady. We got up to the counter, and she ordered this drink, like a chai latte or something. I have no idea what it was. And she ordered it, and the guy, this is like a 25-year-old kid behind the bar, and he said, "Ma'am, we don't have that drink." And she really politely said, "Well, sir, I've ordered it before. I think you do." And he said, "Excuse me? I'm a Starbucks employee. You'd think I'd know what we have, and we do not have that drink." And I looked up on the menu board behind him, and guess what? It was listed right there. And at that point, the Lord spoke to me and told me to start a ministry of beating people up. And no, I'm teasing. But I said, "Excuse me, ma'am." And I stepped up and I said, "Hey, Jack, turn around and look at your menu." He looked in horror and he realized he was a moron. But did he apologize? No. Did he say he was sorry? No. He spun around, took the order, never looked at us in the eye, and just moved on. Now, at that moment, I don't care how much money Starbucks makes, how many millions they spend on their advertising, how brilliant their CEO is. At that moment, that 25-year-old kid was their brand to me. So your ushers, your receptionist, your filmmakers, whoever in your organization touches the public, that is your brand. It needs to trickle down. Am I making any sense? So here's the deal. The rules have changed, so I want to talk about some of the things that you need to think about as we try to cut through the clutter and get our story heard in this 21st century. So the question becomes, what's your story? And maybe more important, how does your story cut through? All right, these are some things I want you to write down. Number one, everything communicates. Everything communicates. I don't care what this theme of that truck is, the ladders on top of that truck give it away. It's a lie. Everything communicates. The way your building looks communicates. Your website communicates a message. The way you walk into a room communicates a message. You know I'm right, because when you meet somebody for the first time, maybe here, you met some people for the first time tonight, and before they open their mouth, you had already sized them up. It's not a great thing, it's just the way human nature is. People start making assumptions immediately. Everything communicates, and we have to be concerned with everything about our organization. The old idea of we're just here to preach the gospel doesn't matter anymore. I have a major league pastor in America was on a talk show the other night with a wacky New Age high priest guy and then a real liberal mainline bishop guy. And this pastor, everything he said, it was a little debate about God and about the Muslims and about the war in the Middle East and all kind of stuff. And everything the pastor said was right. Biblically sound, absolutely accurate. The stuff the other guy said were whacked, completely crazy. And yet, guess what? The pastor lost the debate because he never looked the interviewer in the eye, was grumpy the whole time, never smiled, while the other wacky guys, they were engaging, they were interesting, they were fun. They won the debate, even though what they said was wrong. Trust me, everything communicates. So in a digital age where there are tons of distractions, we have to remember everything communicates. We can't drop anything, let anything fall through the cracks. The second thing is, in a media-driven culture, visibility matters just as much as ability. Our ability to get on the radar is just as important as the message you share once you're there. If we're not intentional about our message and getting it out there, we'll disappear. A lot of organizations I speak to, particularly with pastors and leaders, they say, you know, Phil, I'm just going to take the humble route. I'm going to let the Lord promote me. And that sounds noble and it sounds great and I'm all for that. But the truth is, we live in a world where the stakes are too high to let it go. If we're not willing to step up to the plate and get our message heard, guess what? Another message is going to get heard. We have to be very, very intentional in this world we live in. I know ministry leaders who are brilliant men and women of God who will never, ever get their message heard because they don't know how to get on the radar. College professors who are geniuses, but their influence only goes as far as the university gate because they don't know how to get out there and get their message out there. So we need to start thinking, how do we get on the radar? How do we get noticed? Because that's just as important as the power of our message. The third thing is, you cannot brand a lie. In an email, text message, instant messaging world, word travels fast. As leaders, we need to live more, we need to live lives of integrity more than ever, more transparently. I had a pastor one time tell me, you know, it'd be best, Phil, if you didn't mention to my congregation about my yacht. I said, well, you're an idiot. Because number one, you can go on Google and find the title for the yacht. And number two, you can get Google Earth and download a picture of it sitting at the dock. We live in an age where you cannot hide. Stop looking at Google as search and start thinking about Google as reputation management. You know, that drunk driving arrest you got in college that you thought everybody had forgotten about, it'll show up in a Google search. That divorce that you thought nobody knew about, it'll show up in a Google search. The river of information that flows into Google is absolutely staggering. And we need to think about it. We need to think about it because it's going to happen. It's going to happen. I think the future is about findability, and it's incredibly easy for information to get out there. So understand, you cannot brand a lie. Jimmy Swaggart found that out. Ted Haggart found that out. A lot of political leaders find that out every day here in America. You cannot hide anymore. We just need to live incredibly transparent lives. Number four, in a digital age with thousands of choices, we need to understand the power of a name. The name of your project, the name of your ministry, your initiative, the name of your book. Names matter more than anything. Let me tell you, people will never get past your name today. There's just too many other options. There's too many other things to do. Research tells us on television that people take 2 to 3 seconds to decide whether or not to watch a program. 2 to 3 seconds. That doesn't matter how anointed your program is. If the name does not capture them, forget it. Web research indicates that most people will take 1 second based on the title of your article whether or not to read it online. So I don't care how great the article is, if the name can't capture them, you failed. You failed. It's the first thing people see, and it will open the door to whether or not they go in. So think about that with your ministry, your organization, your initiative, your film, your project, your book. Names matter more than ever. Let me show you a list of names I found of churches here in the U.S. I have no idea. It's amazing. Turkeytown United Methodist, Cooter United Methodist, Runs Baptist Church, my favorite. And yes, there's actually a Hooker Church of Christ. It's in Hooker, Oklahoma. What were they thinking? Hygiene United Methodist, Colon. If anybody goes to these churches, I apologize. King James Bible Baptist. How many people drive up to Nottoway United Methodist Church and think, that's not the church for me? Let me tell you something. Names matter. Names matter. And by the way, let me tell you this. Sometimes names can work in your favor. I found this sign recently. I thought this was pretty good. Community Tent Revival with Brother Jack Daniels. Chances are people are racing to hear him preach. And I showed this at the Louisiana Baptist Convention 6 months ago, and they all broke out laughing. And I said, "Why? What's the deal?" And they said, "Oh yeah, he's one of our evangelists. I finally found Brother Jack Daniels. That's awesome." But don't tell me names don't matter. There's a college in the U.S. in Grand Rapids, Michigan. For years, it's been called Grand Rapids Baptist Bible College. Great school, good reputation. Number of years ago, they dropped the Baptist, so it was Grand Rapids Bible College. Good faculty, good graduates, good school. About 10 years ago, they decided to take one more step. They went from Grand Rapids Bible College to Cornerstone University. Didn't change anything, but in 1 year, enrollment doubled. Doubled. After all, who wants to go to Grand Rapids Bible College? But Cornerstone University? That sounds pretty cool. CBS Sunday Morning did an interesting story a couple months ago on a town in Mississippi called Cowpens, Mississippi. Suburb area, nice town, people liked it. About 5-6 years ago, they changed the name from Cowpens, Mississippi to Olive Branch. They said, since changing the name to Olive Branch, the town has experienced 865% growth and is now the fastest growing metropolitan area in America. And all they did was change the name. Let me tell you something, names matter. Names matter. And by the way, where your name appears matters too. I'm 50-50 on this. I was in a restaurant in North Carolina, went to the bathroom, went racing back and got my camera, and I took this photo. I don't know if this is a good thing or a bad thing. You tell me. You know, my first feeling was I don't want to associate my name and my organization with that spot. On the other hand, you have a lot of time to sit there and read. So maybe it's brilliant advertising. I'm not sure. But I thought that was kind of interesting. And by the way, let me tell you this. Your URL matters. Your URL matters. Not in the normal way. Everybody knows, get the shortest URL you can think of. Get the easiest to spell. Always get the most common misspelling of your URL. Probably some of you don't think about that. You want dumb people to find you too. I'm just teasing. But you do want the most common misspelling of your URL and send it, direct it to your website. People, you want everybody to find you, even if they make a mistake. But let me tell you this. Look at your URL. Ooh, this thing moves. Look at your URL out of context. There's a graphic design company in L.A., really good graphic design company that specializes in getting graphics quick, called Speed of Art. It's a great, great spot. This is their website. But if you look at the URL by itself, that's what it looks like. You don't want to be that company. You don't want to be that company. I found another one that was a great site to find counselors. If you needed a counselor or a therapist, you just dial in your zip code. It's called Therapist Finder. It's a great site. But if you look at it out of context, it's the Rapist Finder. Same word, but it's out of context. You don't want to be that. The last one I thought was interesting was a great site for tech guys. Experts Exchange. Get your computer fixed. URL by itself is Expert Sex Change. You definitely do not want to be that ministry out there. So all I'm saying is think about it. Look at your URL by itself, out of context. Sometimes it says things you don't expect. Number 5, speak the language of design. We live in a design-driven generation. Go to a Verizon store, an Apple store, cell phone stores, wherever you are. We live in a design-driven generation. And let me tell you something, this culture responds to design. Your website, your brochures, the interior design of your organization, whatever you do, think about the design. It will make a huge, huge impact. And let me tell you something, let me explode a myth for you that many of you are getting pushed because people say, well, Phil, I'd like to be more contemporary. I'd like to make our company look more hip. But older people are our donors. The older audience are our donors, so we have to be careful. We don't want to be too cool and hip. Let me tell you something. The fastest growing market segment for buying mobile devices is senior citizens. And yet, when was the last time you saw Apple do a commercial with an old guy on his walker listening to his iPhone? They don't. Why? Because old people want to be cool too. Old people want to be cool too. So never ever think you need to dumb down your design because your donors are older. Never. Trust me. They will embrace it faster than you think. You have to sell it to them. You have to talk to them in a way that'll bring them on board. But trust me, I've had so much experience with so many organizations, and older people embrace it. And what I fought for 2 years with one organization, finally did a survey. You know the responses we got? My grandson loves Facebook. You want to get this ministry on Facebook? We'll support it. We'll fund it tomorrow. You want to be cooler online? Great, because I want to reach my grandkids. Old people are smarter than you think. They get it. They want to be cool. But I will tell you this. There are four designs, four things, four images I'd like you to not use anymore. If I can get rid of these images from the Christian world, and I'll die a happy man. And they are flags, globes, doves, and flames. Please don't use those anymore. Nothing wrong with those images except everybody uses them. We can get in the car and drive 5 miles in any direction, and trust me, we will find one or more of these images on a church sign somewhere. They're all over the place. And trust me, when you use an image so much, it loses its meaning. It loses its meaning. Think about the power of an image. God chose to introduce himself to us as the creator. First verse of Genesis. And yet, how much do we just rip stuff off and use it over and over again until we wear it out? If we cannot find a more creative way to express who we are to this generation, we need to pack it up. We need to pack it up. I spoke at a pastor's conference a couple years ago, and I showed this, and a pastor walked up to me later and said, "Phil, you have cut me to the quick." And he handed me his business card that had all four images on the card. But because it was a business card, they were all kind of crammed in, and it looked like the dove was on fire crashing into the globe. It was pitiful, pitiful. But he got it. He got it. So it's incredibly important. In fact, let me tell you something. I'm careful how I use the cross. You guys are professional communicators. You know this better than me, but you know the early church never used the cross as a symbol of the Christian faith until the last person who had actually witnessed a Roman execution had died. The idea of using a Roman execution tool to express who we are, that was an anathema to the early church. They would never consider that. It would be like Jesus was alive today. If he died 2,000 years from now, people would be wearing electric chair jewelry. That electric chair bracelet you're wearing is precious. I just love that. That is gorgeous. Let me tell you something. That doesn't mean Phil says don't use the cross. It means Phil says explain it. Make sure you use it in a way that has meaning. Make sure you get your audience to understand its power and what it represents. Don't just throw it out there because it's the cross and we're all used to it and we kind of get it. This is the first generation most of us have grown up in that absolutely is ignorant of all things Christian. Absolutely ignorant. I was in downtown L.A. We have a place in downtown L.A. called the Jewelry Mart. It's a four-square block area of just amazing little shops and stores where you can buy wholesale jewelry. It's just incredible. And so I snuck down a couple years ago to get a gift for my wife for Christmas because I'm an awesome husband. And I was standing at this jewelry kiosk next to a 30-something couple. And they were very well-to-do. And I have the spiritual gift of listening to what other people are saying, so I was overhearing their conversation. And the guy brought out a tray of cross necklaces, beautiful necklaces. And they were real simple on one end, and they got more ornate and more ornate, and they got to be kind of Catholic-style crosses, you know, with Jesus on them down at the other end. They're all gorgeous. So this girl's looking at them, and I overheard her say, "You know, these necklaces are wonderful." And she's moving down the tray, and she says, "I love these. These are gorgeous." Then she got to the end, and she said, "Whoa, whoa, whoa, whoa. Hang on a second. Who's the little guy on the necklace? Why is there a little guy on this cross necklace?" 35-year-old woman in L.A. had no clue who the little guy on the cross necklace was. That's the people we're reaching. We can't just throw images out anymore and expect people to understand them. We need to make sure they connect, make sure they get it, and it's incredibly, incredibly important. By the way, video is really interesting right now. It's becoming the hottest marketing tool on the web out there with ministries. 85% of internet users watch it regularly. And more interesting to me, the 55 and older audience watches as many online videos as the 20-something audience. Pretty remarkable. In fact, 49% of all video viewers online have asked for more information about the product they're watching. What could that mean for you? What could that mean for us? Online video is becoming far more powerful. And let me give you a secret. Stop doing videos about how awesome you are. Stop mentioning numbers. It's not about facts. It's not about how many meals we distributed, how many people got saved under our ministry. It's not how many stations we have. Video is about emotion. Print is about information. You want to tell them all that stuff, great. Print it out and give them to them in a brochure. Put it on a website. But if you do a video, you do a video not about how awesome you are, but about someone whose life was changed because of what you do. That's what will touch people. That's what video, that's the power of video, is to tell emotional stories. That's what touches people's lives. Those are the kind of videos you ought to be thinking about. Number six. It's time to get social about, it's time to take social media seriously. It's time to take it seriously. It's the way we connect with the world. If you're not engaging a real serious strategy about social media, you're making a huge mistake. 50% of the population of this world is under 30 years old. It's now the number one activity on the web. It's displaced porn as the number one activity on the web, which is a good thing. 1 in 5 couples now meet online through social media channels. In fact, I'll tell you this, in California, where I live, 1 in 7 divorces now have Facebook somewhere in the divorce proceedings. So it's good and it's bad, but the truth is, it's the way people connect, and we need to take it seriously. Twitter, Facebook, Pinterest, whatever platform you use, you need to have a serious look at how you can use it as a tool for reaching people. Stop tweeting pictures of your latte at Starbucks or the salad you had at Denny's and start thinking seriously about how you can engage. I'll tell you this, I've got about 25,000 people follow me on Twitter. So in a weird way, I'm the pastor of one of the largest churches in America. I take that very seriously. What I share with those people, I have fun with them, but I take it very seriously. You want to know some of my, let me give you some ways. If you want to amp up your social media, let me give you some quick little tips here. This is good. You know, the single biggest reason people follow you on social media? They want to know what it's like to be you. They want to know what it's like to be you. Chances are, there are a lot of people out there that can't call you up and have coffee, can't sit down and kick around ideas, can't sit around and pick your brain about stuff, but they would love to know what your world is like. Stop just giving them cheesy quotes or throwing out Bible verses, and start giving them an intimate behind-the-scenes look at what your life is like, and you will have more followers than you can imagine. I tell pastors all the time, you know, Saturday night when you're struggling to come up with a message, that's what I want to hear about on social media. Right before you walk out to do the funeral of somebody you've cared about and you've loved for years, I want to know what you're struggling with. And you as a leader, when you're at a crossroads, I want to know what you're going through. What do you think about that? That's the number one thing. Tell me what it's like to be you. You start sharing that and giving me intimate look, insider look, at what that's like and the struggles you go to, you'll start finding followers. Obviously, you want to encourage people. I'm big on quotes and stuff. I'm sick of cheesy quotes. But if you know, great quotes, it'll help me be a better leader, a better media producer, a better dad, whatever. I love it. And also, you know what? Don't be afraid to be provocative. Throw a hand grenade out there every once in a while. I think in the Christian community, one of the greatest sins I think we commit is we're just too stinking nice. Jesus just wasn't nice. He was not afraid to light up a room. He was not afraid to throw people out of the temple. He was not afraid to stop religious leaders in their tracks and call them out. We don't always have to be nice. And it doesn't mean you have to be controversial just to be a jerk. Just throw a hand grenade out there. Be provocative. Ask those tough questions that everybody's thinking, but nobody's asking. That'll get you followers. That's actually what'll get you retweeted. People share that. They love to share that. It's time to get serious. And you know what? I've written before that with 1 billion users, Facebook is now the 3rd largest country in the world. So who's sending missionaries to that country? Who's planting churches in that country? You know, if there's anything I'm trying to get people to do is stop thinking of missions in terms of geographical boundaries and start thinking of missions in terms of digital boundaries. That's the country of the future that we need to really have a strategy for reaching. And trust me, everybody is on a mobile device. I've been all over the world. Wayne mentioned 50 countries I've shot in. I don't know if I've been to a place that doesn't have mobile devices in some form. I love the shot in the upper right of the Indian holy man with a cigarette and a cell phone. Don't say America hasn't impacted the world. And the three guys in the lower left during the Egyptian uprising, two are fighting for their life, and the third is checking his email on his cell phone. You never know when that important email is going to come through. You just never know. A recent book called Abundance came out recently and said that a Maasai warrior in the heart of Africa with a cell phone now has access to more information than the President of the United States did just 15 years ago. That's the kind of change that's happening out there. In fact, as of January, there are more mobile devices than people in the world. As of 2 months ago, there are more mobile devices in India than toilets. I have no idea the implications of that, but I'll just throw it out there to you. But trust me, everybody has a mobile device, and people are 3 times more likely to watch your video on a mobile device than on their laptop. So always be thinking about that, because I believe, and I've had many, many arguments with ministry leaders about this, you know, it's not hanging up a sheet in the middle of the bush and showing your 16-millimeter movie anymore. It's about showing a short film on an iPhone in a subway in Tokyo. That's the way the future of evangelism looks. And I think we need to be ready for that. We really need to be ready for that. And the last thing I tell you is, number 7, and that's, it's all about the niche. Or as you Brits say, the niche. All about the niche. Stop trying to be all things to all people. One thing I've learned in 30-some years of working with some of the largest organizations in the world is that the people that get noticed, the organizations that make an impact, are not the organizations that do a lot of stuff pretty well. They're the organizations that do one thing extraordinarily well. Because in today's cluttered culture, being half good is never going to cut through. Being extraordinary will get you noticed. And think about it, for yourself as a leader, and I think it's true for organizations, but I think it's true for you. So many of us try to be good at a bunch of different things, but we're not really very good at it. The woman that has the most Grammy Awards in history, you know the music Grammy Awards? The woman that has the most Grammy Awards in history by a long shot, in fact, I don't think anybody will ever really catch up, is not Barbra Streisand, it's not Aretha Franklin, it's not Celine Dion or Beyonce. The woman that has the most by a wide margin is Alison Krauss, the bluegrass player. You know why? I don't care what happens in the rest of the Grammy Awards every year. When it comes to the bluegrass category, she will walk away with most of them because she owns that niche. She's become the best in the world at a really small niche, and as a result, she gets noticed. In fact, she's so big now, she's recorded a rock album with Robert Plant. She's recording a classical album. She can do anything she wants now. Why? Because she got noticed for being extraordinary at one big thing. What is that thing for you? What is that big thing for you? And it's not that you only do one thing for your life. I compare it to, my pastor for 20-some years has been Jack Hayford, Church on the Way here in Los Angeles. Many of you know Jack. Jack's like the Protestant Pope. Jack has preached on everything imaginable. In 20-some years, I've heard him preach on everything you can possibly think of. But you know what? If you cut Jack, he will bleed worship. He's written 5 worship books. He's written 100 worship songs. Everything that Jack does, he does through the lens of worship. If he teaches on prophecy, he does it through the lens of worship. If he teaches on forgiveness, he does it through the lens of worship. Whatever he teaches on, finances, family life, it doesn't matter. He does it through the lens of worship because that's the focus of his life. And that's why that's why people pay attention to Jack. That's why people notice him. That's why people want to hear what he has to say. That one big thing, think about it. As you focus your message and your ministry and your organization, think about that niche. The tighter the niche, the better, because it's the way to get noticed. I was in Africa early in my career. In fact, I was working with Theo here from Ghana 25 years ago we first met, I think. And we were filming a number of projects, but I got to interview a guy named Nicholas Bingu. Anybody know Nicholas from the old days in Africa? Great man, great man. But Time magazine called him the Billy Graham of Africa because he had led more Africans to Christ than any man in history. And when I was filming, he was in his, oh gosh, late 70s then, and he's died obviously since. But I sat him down to do this interview with him, and I said, that's a remarkable statistic. You've led more Africans to Christ than any other African in history. I said, tell me about that. He was a real humble guy, and he said, well, you know what, let me tell you a different story. And he took me back many, many, many years before when a missionary, young missionary couple had come to Africa from the U.S., and they were very excited, all pumped up, coming to preach, but apparently they weren't very good at it. And so they would preach, nobody would accept Christ. Years later, they'd come to the U.S. on furlough. Can you imagine trying to raise money for work that you didn't have a single convert to report? But they were faithful, and they'd go back. They built a church. Nobody came. And after years of ministering in Africa, the only person they even made contact with was this little kid that would help them carry their equipment. Otherwise, they did not have one single conversion. Finally, years and years later, their denomination said, look, this is embarrassing. We got to bring these people back. We can't keep funding these guys. They're terrible at this. So they called him home. It was humiliating. It was embarrassing. In fact, in those days, they traveled by boat. When they got to the dock to leave Africa, the only person to see him off, after spending their whole adult life in ministry in Africa, the only person that came to see him off was that little kid helping him with their equipment. They get on the boat. They come back to the U.S., and he said it wasn't many years before they both passed away. They were so embarrassed, so humiliated, because they'd been a complete failure. Nicholas looked at me and said, you know what? What they didn't realize was, I was that little kid. I was that little kid. God did not send them to Africa to reach one person or five people or 100 people. He sent them to Africa to reach me. And since that time, I've led more people to Christ in this nation than in this continent than any man in history. And I always think of that story when I think about you guys, because you create media. You don't know who's watching. You don't know who's listening. You don't know who's reading your website. It's very hard to tell in what we do. We're not pastors who see people come forward when you do an altar call. We create media that goes out there, and bless God, we just hope it does the job. And we pray that God uses it. Let me tell you something. I believe He does. I believe He does. And I think this week, as we launch this week, we need to really ratchet it up as far as how serious we need to be. Because I think the issues we're talking about and the things we're discussing have the power to completely redefine missions in a digital age. I want to be one of those guys. 100 years from now, people look back at this gathering and these people in the room and say, you know what? Those guys completely shifted the church away from a 200-year-old model into a way that completely changed the way the world was reached with the gospel. The bottom line is we've got to get out of the habit of giving our congregation or our visitors, our donors, what we think they want and start giving them what we never dreamed possible. Thank you, guys. I appreciate letting me come.